Session with a review of several normalization techniques for learning deep neural networks. As many of you probably know, recently several different normalization techniques such as batch normalization, weight normalization, normalization propagation have been suggested for simplifying the process of learning of deep neural networks. And it is, several of them have been already mentioned on our seminars in the last and previous semester. But probably it's quite interesting to see what is the common thing in these different normalization techniques. And hopefully Alex will give some hints of the generality of these different normalization techniques.
I'll do my best. Okay, thank you. Right, so let's start from the problem setting. Say we want to train some model, for example, logistic regression. But the details doesn't matter that much, just any machine learning classification or regression task. This is just for something specific. And if our data is skewed, so if it has different mean and variance, which is like really, really non-standard normal, you can experience some problems with learning, with minimizing this kind of loss. So if you just run a gradient descent, it can converge really slowly. Here I tried to just run to train this logistic regression with different optimizers, and here we have really skewed data. So I added some random noise so we have like this feature vector X, and this first feature vector, second, etc. And to all of them, I added just one bias and multiplied them by the same scale, which I generated from some uniform distribution, just to make the data worse. And originally it was missed, but now it's like skewed missed. And I tried to learn this logistic regression with different optimizers, and you can see that then the data is skewed. Like you can really benefit from, maybe the results are not that insightful, but the idea was to show that if your data is skewed, then it can be hard to train with gradient descent. I like spent some time to find learn that rate that works. You can see that it's really low, because if you make it larger, then it just diverge, and the convergence is kind of slow.
Excuse me, just to be clear, why Andrew just trajectory is not
I have no idea. You just run side by.
But if you draw the criterion function that you actually minimize here, certainly it should be minimized monotonically, because that's how AWS works.
Well, it's probably...
Maybe you draw something like a norm of a gradient, some different thing, and not the criterion you minimize.
Well, I think you're right, and I just made some mistakes, so we can discard this LBFGS plot. Yes?
Sorry, R, S, and A stochastic, or...?
No, they all not stochastic. Just, like, I have 5,000 examples and run them all on each
stage. So dataset is fixed, but only different.
Sorry?
The dataset is fixed, but it's a little bit different than the original one.
Yes.
Can you say that without normalization, optimization methods are crucially dependent on the parameters, such as learning rate, and so on. And the normalization helps to avoid the dependence.
Yes, I was hoping to like make this clear. You can see that here we can use large learning rates, and it kind of learns faster. And actually, here you can see that the loss is like 1, and here the loss is like order of magnitude better. So it's kind of helps, right? Just normalizing the data with PCE and like uncorrelating it divided by the standard deviation. Okay, so...
And what kind of normalization have been used here?
It's like whitening, when you make everything non-correlated and standard variance and standard mean. So now if you have a neural network, like some complex system with functions, with composite functions, you have the same problem, but it gets worse. Because So first of all, you have the same problem, because if you exhibit this kind of convergence problems in the previous slide, you will have the same here. But now you can also look at this model by parts. So you can say that this part of the network is just logistic regression that takes as input some data that was prepared by the first part of the network, right? And now you can say that if this part of the network, this logistic regression, gets as inputs non-standard data, it will be hard to learn, right? Because we observed it on the previous slide. So now we have these kind of problems on each layer. And even worse, this distribution is not only standard, but it also changes over time. While you're training, these things change, and the distribution that the output changed. And so this layer has to not only deal with this skewed data, but it has to adapt to changes in the distribution. And this should probably make the convergence slower, and like if we can fix it, it would be really good. Okay, so one more thing I wanted to say here is that this degree of freedom, like being able to change the output distribution here, is not really that important. So you can actually, for example, multiply all the outputs here by 10, and then divide all the inputs here by 10 by the weights, right? So you can imagine lots of different distributions here that will lead to the same loss. That's why the gradient descent optimization can kind of get crazy about like choosing different distributions on each iteration, because it doesn't that matter. That doesn't really matter for it, right? It can like change it, and the loss doesn't change. So it can change it on each iteration, and making its life worse because this part has to adapt every time. And also, the gradient descent is making at each step it's changing the whole network. And it can think like, okay, I will change this thing, the output distribution will change, but it's okay, because I can fix it like on the next step, right? And it will also change this thing, thinking that the output distribution here, it can fix it. But all these changes here are kind of accumulating, and on each step, you can change the distribution here really, really hugely, because you change lots of layers here, and all of them, all the changes accumulated to change the distribution really much. And originally, the gradient descent thought that it wouldn't matter that much because we had fixed it here, but it just slowed down the convergence. Okay, this was the original motivation of the batch normalization paper. And they said, okay, let's fix it. Let's just normalize between each layer. So if the normalization helped here before, if we have just logistic regression, we can normalize the input data to each layer. But how to do it? Well, one thing we can do is to, after each step of the gradient descent or stochastic gradient descent, we can just compute the statistics of the outputs of each layer and compute like the mean and the variance with respect to the whole data set and normalize the data. Right. So I forgot to mention that the first thing they decided to do is to just instead of not whitening, do not care about correlation, but just normalize, because it's just cheaper and it can help anyway. So in batch normalization, they do not try to whiten data, they just do something like y
shift on the scale.
Right, so it would be like I divided by variance yi minus this was like their hope to obtain a formula like this. So after each iteration of the gradient descent, you can obtain the statistics of activations, like their mean and variance, and normalize. And but if you do it, you kind of breaking the gradient descent optimization, right? So you, after each step of the optimization procedure, you're kind of changing your model, and it will not So what I'm saying is that if your optimization procedure would be like this, step of gradient descent, then change the weights so that activations would be identically distributed. I mean, not identically, but normally distributed. You can do it, but you're kind of breaking the gradient descent procedure.
Wait. But we're not changing the weights during the normalization step. We're scaling the outputs, right?
But, well, I'm just trying to derive the batch normalization, like, from... it's the first thing to try, right?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So you can do it, but it will break the gradient descent, because you kind of... instead of just doing step of optimization, you kind of, after each step, you change your model. And
yes, and during this second step, we may reduce the quality of the model, right?
Yes.
We can make the situation even worse.
And you don't have any guarantees anymore from the optimization point.
Is this because of leakage of information from batch to the variables, or is it because... I thought that normalization layer was also like implemented in the same way, and it was gradient descent that applied for weights and also batch parameters.
But we do not have.
Why is it broken?
Normalization layer. Yep.
Ah, okay. Sorry.
We're only trying to derive why it's needed.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Okay. So to fix this problem, we can say that okay, let's change our model instead and put this normalization inside the forward pass.
Inside the computational graph.
Yes. So we will say that on the forward pass, we will say we have like one test input here. We'll put it from the first layer. Then we will put the whole training data set of images through this the same layer. Compute its statistics like mean and variance. And then normalize the output of our test image. And then do this for each layer. This way, you change the forward pass, and now you can back propagate through the whole thing. So you can compute the gradient descent with respect to all these operations that you added to your network. And now you don't try to, you're not fighting with gradient descent. You're kind of working. They're kind of working together. But it's still very slow because we have to put the whole data set on each training step, right? So they just said, like, let's use stochastic gradients, let's use batches. So let's compute the statistics with respect to the batches. So on each training iteration, we will sample like 100 of training images, compute the mean and variance of each for each layer of the activations, normalize the activations, and then it would be one step of the forward pass. And when we can backpropagate through the whole procedure. Does it make sense? Okay, cool. So, and one more thing they added, they said that, okay, we kind of invented a layer which we can put in between the actual layers, which will normalize stuff. But this layer cannot represent identity transform just yet, because it necessarily changes the output of each layer to be standard. And maybe in some situations it's not the best thing to do. Maybe at sometimes we don't need it. So let's put back this kind of degree of freedom and we will obtain the batch normalization procedure. So on each step it computes these statistics with respect to the mini batch. Then it normalized the outputs of each layer. And then it also added this scale and and shift parameter which they train. And this way now the layer itself, it can, if it thinks that it's the best thing to do, it can set the gamma to be the standard deviation and set the beta to be mu.
Yes, but the standard deviation and beta are different for different mini batches.
Well, we will expect them to be approximately the same. Uh-huh. So, in principle, it can implement something like an identity transform now. You may think that now like we get rid of all the advantages because now we again have non-standard distribution of the outputs. But I think the idea was that now we don't have this kind of butterfly effect, that small changes of the whole layer, of the all layers of the network will change the distribution of the last layer really, really hugely, right? Now we guarantee that the distribution will not change in this part, and here we directly control like how it will change, and we can like slightly adjust the distribution. So this is batch normalization. I think it's 2015, not 16.
Yes. 2016.
Kingma as well. Wasn't it like
is it 2016?
It's 15, I just 15. Said. And the same thing for a few layer neural network with four kind of layers. Probably again you don't want to trust the LBFGS, but gradient descent and atom should work. And here you can see that then the data is normalized. You can obtain with these fancy optimization methods like ADAM or LBFGS, you can obtain really good accuracies. But gradient descent struggles because you have lots of layers, and here we don't have any momentum or any fancy ideas. And if you put the skewed, if you do not normalize your data, I mean just input data. We don't care about the normalization between the layers. Then you all the optimization methods kind of struggle to get any decent performance.
So do we have batch normalization on the right picture?
No batch normalization anywhere. Just normalized the input data.
Okay.
So probably if you put batch normalization, this plot will be better, but I didn't have time to do it. Right. Okay, so some pros and cons of batch normalization. It speeds up the convergence, so actually you can use larger learning rates without everything diverging. And they claim that with batch normalization you don't actually need dropout because it adds lots of stochastic stuff inside your network. And
what means?
Because each mini batch like has slightly different statistics, and you have this kind of stochastic variations, and most of the papers on large systems do not use dropout. But I heard that it still
recently
helps.
There were several papers which shows that it can be combined together and.
Okay. But originally they claimed that like it's just you don't need dropout for it if you use batch normalization. Also, they claim that if you use so nowadays people in neural networks use this kind of activation functions, which called really. It's max between 0 and x. And the reason for that is because it has, in half of this of the x space, it has a reasonably good gradient, like non-zero gradient. Before that, people used this kind of activation functions, like sigmoid or hyperbolic tangents. These things had almost zero gradient almost everywhere, which kind of also made the convergence worse. And the paper on batch normalization claims that if you use batch normalization, then these problems kind of becomes much less severe. Because previously, then the distribution of activations could change rapidly on each step. You can accidentally go to this region of space, and you will never recover because the gradient is small. You can't go back. Now you can directly control the distribution of activations, and if you go here, you probably did it on purpose. So with batch normalization, you can use the sigmoid activations, and it's kind of works. But finally, batch normalization seems really hacky because they tried to solve optimization problem, like problem with the optimization procedure, but they changed the model in a really strange way. First of all, we do not treat the data points as independent anymore because they like process the batch as a whole. And I don't know, just batch normalization seems really strange. And if we can avoid it, it would be good. But anyway, like almost everyone now use it. And if you want to train, for example, ResNets with hundreds of layers, you just can't do it without some kind of normalization or another. Right.
that batch normalization is not a very good technique of normalization for reinforcement learning, or not?
I don't know. But I heard that with that normalization propagation somewhere claimed that it's kind of better than batch normalization in this sense.
I read that in reinforcement learning you don't really want to have a lot of noise.
Reason why normalization propagation, which do not have noise, can be better in this aspect. So let's move to normalization propagations. Alternative technique, recently proposed one, and their idea is really simple. So let's say that you already know that the inputs of your network are standard Gaussians, independent standard Gaussians. So you did the whitening on the input images. Now you have your first layer, and the first layer just do the linear transformation. Let's say for a minute. The output of this layer will have also zero mean, because it's just how expectation works. And we can compute its covariance matrix, and it would be like the old covariance, something like that.
And the old covariance was
disabled.
Yes.
So
vice versa.
Yes. Okay. But so now we want to make this thing as close to identity as possible, right? We want to propagate. So the idea originally is to propagate this property that all activations are identical, are standard Gaussians. And if we can do it, we can always rely on the fact that the input to our layer is standard Gaussian. And we can try to avoid looking at the data points. If we know the distribution of the inputs, we can just, from the form of your function, we can just know how to change the output so it will be also standardly distributed.
Do we really need the distributional assumption that is it is normal, or
right
do
now,
we
no.
need the moments?
For most of the parts would not rely on normality, just moments.
Okay.
So yes, now we want to know how to change the output of this layer so it would be also as identically distributed as possible. And we can say that so the diagonal entries of this matrix are just its ith row of W transpose I. So if we rescale this matrix to have unit length rows this, then we will guarantee that the outputs will also have a standard deviation equals to 1.
Yes, but they will have some correlations.
Yes. So this is the first idea. So let's propagate this property through the linear layer like this. And
so you mean that we'll need to normalize each row of matrix W, right?
Yes.
So this is some kind of constraint optimization problem.
Yes, but instead of constraint optimization, they just reparameterize. So they say that ui will now be vix divided by n. Okay, your note about they are not independent. To analyze this property, they say they propose an upper bound on like the quantity that measures how decorrelated they are. They say that the distance between this covariance matrix and the closest diagonal matrix
is upper bounded by the quantity that measures how correlated the rows in the W are. It's just cosine distance between the rows. It kind of makes sense. It says that if your matrix is unitary, which means that its rows are orthogonal and unit length, then if you multiply the unitary matrix by a standard normal, you will get standard normal, which is decorrelated. And if it's not the case, but it's approximately the case, then you will have approximately not correlated outputs. So this thing is small but not zero, you will have still something small here. Okay, now we have some non-linearity, right? We would like to compute something like ReLU of this quantity. And we also want to propagate this standard normal property through this ReLU. Well, if you just care about the moments, it's easy, because the mathematical expectation of this thing with respect to x, if you know that x is standard normal, is, so we assume here that the input is already standard normal. And then this expectation would be integral 1 to plus infinity of normal density. Times x, right? So it's like mean of the standard Gaussian, but it's from 0 to plus infinity because you have ReLU, which kind of cut into the half of the space. And this is kind of easy because you just put this thing here and you end up with 1 divided by 2y. Same way you can derive the standard deviation of this ReLU of y, you will have squared here, squared x, and you will have to use integration by parts. And you will obtain that the variance is variance of ReLU is half x. So now we have the mean and variance of the output of our layer. And we can just adjust these outputs to make these outputs to be standard normal, right? And one last thing, they also add two parameters that they learn, which can control the scale of the shift. So finally, they obtain a formula like this. Here we have our original linear layer, like ith output of it. We normalize it divided by the norm of matrix. We add two parameters which we learn to let this transformation be able to represent identity transform. We compute the ReLU, and finally we just subtract this computed mean and divide by the standard deviation. So now instead of the batch normalization, which is kind of external procedure which you put it inside your neural network, now we just have to, instead of the usual layer like this, ReLU of WX, you will just have to use this kind of parameterization. And this will approximately guarantee you that all the activations on all the hidden layers will be approximately standard Gauss. and it can help your convergence with gradient descent. Okay.
How can we guarantee that different components of the output are not correlated?
We cannot. They just provide this upper bound
and
hope for the best. they say that like on practice they observe that this quantity is usually small for matrices trained in neural networks.
So we do not imply these constraints somehow.
No, we just hope that it stays.
Actually, we can say that if we take the weights from normal distribution, then due to central limit theorem, if we have
yes, but then we train them and they like change in real and non-number anyway.
Yes, but we already have some assumptions on normality of our input as a model example. So here we can also hope that our weights are something that are taken from normal distribution, and that's why it will be actually correlated.
Well, on the inputs, we do not have to assume anything. We can just explicitly whiten it, like explicitly make it standard normal. Just as a preprocessing step of the data set.
No. We can only normalize their statistics, but we can't rely that they're actually normal.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
But if we assume that, we get everything that we want.
Mm-hmm. You assume what?
That the data are from normal distribution and that weights are also from normal distribution and we have enough dimension. That's enough for that everything.
Okay, what dimension?
That
time.
We have enough dimension. Because we have used here central limit theorem. So that's the sum here in this under this max have a lot of terms. Mm-hmm. It's important.
Well, but the assumption that the data is approximately normal is sounds valid. But the assumption that the weights are approximately normal is kind of strange because you train them with respect to some objective.
Yes, but in practice we do observe that the weights are really distributed. Quite close to normal distribution.
And turning to the question about do we need really need normality, we use it here, right? In these derivations. Also, you can say that the output of value is definitely not normal because it's like half of normal, right? But they say that this output of this value will go through another linear layer, so we will sum lots of these half normals with some different weights, and due to central limit theorem, it will be approximately normal. And the moments would be okay because we made them okay.
At the last layer.
Sorry?
I mean, like, you said just right now that there, to take effect, this hypothesis requires that activation goes through a lot of layers. And on those layers, when it accumulates normality, it's not normal. Isn't that contradicts the idea of trying to sustain normality at each layer?
I didn't get it. So
it's not normal, but it's close enough to not accumulate error, but reduce it.
So what's the question?
Forget about it.
You may try asking in Russian.
Ошибку. Вот в чем смысл ненормальности? То есть они пытаются сделать, чтобы нормально было на каждом слое.
Да.
Но здесь понятно, что это ненормально. Но будет, если накопится, то будет нормально, когда накопится.
Нет, в смысле, у нас несколько выходов, и на нейрон приходит много входов, мы все складываем, получаем вход нормальный.
А, окей, то есть это в сумме должно быть нормально?
Ну да.
Это же тренировано.
То есть если у нас предыдущий. Вот у нас предыдущая активация. Выходы из.
Саша, speaking,
go back.
Okay. So we have in the previous layer we have activations and all of them are half normals, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And now we have a new layer with one normal neuron and it's like sum of and it's approximately normal.
I thought it was like for the layer expression, not for the node.
Okay. I also wanted to
what is the target value?
Sorry?
Well, we have a target value of the neural network. Is it assumed to be normal or.
Which value?
The last layer.
Target variable.
Oh, so this you're asking, do we need to use this normalization in the last layer? Probably not. So probably we do not care about the distribution of the last layer, which is the target layer. Yes?
Do you use discrete axis?
Discrete axis? Probably yes. Why not?
They aren't normal.
Well, makes sense. Probably they will be after passing through the first layer because it's again some with non-integer weights, some of lots of different stuff.
So actually, what we are trying to keep is not normality, but zero mean and unit variance.
Yes, but to compute this pi's here, we have to assume something close to normality.
By the way, we don't have the real independence.
Yes.
We only cross our fingers and hope for the best that we have non-correlated activations. I don't remember exactly, but what does central limit theorem says about dependent random variables? I think last time I checked it didn't apply to this case.
You should check after. I don't know, I mean, they made lots of assumptions which do not hold, but they end up with this kind of parameterization, which you can use even if all the assumptions are not valid, right? It's just another parameterization. And then they observe in practice that it helps, because they approximately holds. But it's not like if the assumptions do not hold that everything fails. It will be anyway be better, a little bit better than it was originally.
So this is some kind of robust procedure.
Yeah.
And how many data sets they are observed the effect of this normalization on?
I don't know, like ImageNet, CIFAR, like all the standard ones.
Okay, for vision.
Yes.
Can you combine it with Drupal? No, the reason I'm asking is not the one you're thinking.
I don't know. Let me check. Just, I will just control F the dropout in the paper. Okay, I wanted also to highlight some similarities to the even more recently proposed way to normalize neural networks, which is called weight normalization. We just basically say that, like, the core why this idea works is this part. We kind of disentangle the norm of your parameters, and we make one of the parts of the parameters is a matrix of unit norm, and the other part is its norm, which is learned. So this is the most important part, and the other parts can be discarded. And they just propose this kind of layer, which they say that worse, like not worse. And they also do not consider different roles, we just normalize the whole matrix.
But can it happen that such transformation is computationally much more expensive?
Which one?
This one, where you have to compute the norm.
It's not true about the norm of the whole matrix.
Yes, okay, I might be wrong.
Because you make weight normalization for each neuron separately.
Okay.
So I think it's not true.
So
this is norm of matrix row.
I think yes.
But it doesn't really matter in terms of computational complexity because it's Frobenius norm, it's just sum of norms. But you're right, probably.
Sum of absolute values?
Sum of norms.
Squares.
Not squares.
I mean, Frobenius norm is just sum of squares of all elements. And they also proposed kind of good initialization. They just say that let's, on the first iteration of the network, let's pass the whole data set through the network, or just some subsample of it, and update the parameters in such a way that all the activations would be standard normals. Like we'll have standard normal distribution.
There is an initialization of gamma and B, or?
Yes. So it's kind of batch normalization, but with the whole data set and only for the initialization. So they add this, yes, they initialize gamma and B, and it works reasonably well. Okay.
But this is still normalization propagation, not weight normalization.
No, this is weight normalization.
This is
okay, let me fix it.
Yeah.
let me be strong.
Almost weight normalization, but not.
Aren't they keeping the amplitude map of the vectors as well?
They do not keep it, but they learn it separately, like in a separate learnable variable. So the output will be estimation.
The weight normalization can
this
be regarded as some kind of simplification.
Sorry?
The weight normalization can be regarded as some kind of simplification of normalization propagation.
Did you see some comparison on these techniques?
No. And on the red discussion they like said, oh, it would be cool to find some, but I can't.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, concerning training time, it is true that this technology requires more time than usual normalization because we have additional things to computational graph and that requires time to put train records.
What do you mean when you say usual normalization?
I mean without any normalization.
Oh, okay.
Usual, non-existent.
But it works better, so.
Yeah, but batch norm also kind of expensive.
Yes.
In terms of computational
model. I think it's cheaper.
This one is cheaper, yes.
Isn't it drop-in replacement as well? I mean, like they say it in the paper that you can just reparameterize the weights, just use all of the normalize all of them, and just use the amplitude as another variable.
It's
and
the
you
same.
Can, yeah.
It's the same. Here, gamma is a magnitude, and W is a.
So, yeah, I mean, like.
What is your question?
I remember, I don't know correctly or not, in the paper they say that yeah, you can just change your weights. You computed them before by just adding on the area and summing, but now you just, you gotta normalize at least. Yeah.
So some pros and cons of normalization propagation. It looks much better than batch normalization because we don't add anything external, we just change the way we parameterize fully connected layers, and we can also make the same thing for convolution layers as well. It doesn't depend on the data statistics, so it allows for batch sizes as low as one. They also claim that, like in neural networks, if you have lots of layers, the Jacobian of each layer, of the transformation of each layer, if it's approximately norm preserving, which means that. So if we put a vector inside of a layer and its norm will not change, it means we do not have any vanishing or exploding gradients problem, right? Because it cannot explode or vanish because its norm doesn't change. The way to mathematically characterize this property is to look at the Jacobian, which is the matrix of first order derivatives. So we have layer F. Have xi string. And if we look into singular values of this matrix, and if they're close to 1, then it means that if they're exactly 1, it means that the norm is not changing, then you use it as a linear layer. Then you pass vectors through F.
If all singular values are close to 1.
Yes.
Maximum.
Maximum or all?
No,
because maximum is actually a norm.
But okay,
and
if you have a lot of or if your
if
maximum single value is one and then
a matrix
have a lot
like
of
this,
yes.
Small,
and
matrix,
it's a norm will change if we multiply.
Yes,
right.
So we need to have
anyway. We have an upper bound.
But
okay,
we're not talking about upper bound. We're talking about preserving norm, and this is only possible if all single values are close to one.
Okay, so they claim that if you treat this whole transformation as a layer, then its Jacobian singular values would be 1.2, approximately 1.2. Yes, we can compute it now. It's
all single values or maximum single values?
All.
How can it happen? I would tell that at least one singular should be close to zero because there's a rule here that nullifies output.
Well, they mean expected singular value. Like you compute a singular value with respect to x, and then you put expectation outside with respect to Gaussian with respect to x. So the Jacobian is like, if you have time to compute it, you can do it. I know if it's interesting.
Does this conclusion also applies to first order optimization methods?
Which one?
I mean, like about Jacobians.
Like if the singular values of Jacobian of each layer is one, all the singular values, then you are guaranteed that you do not have any vanishing or exploding gradients problem, right?
So it's a theoretical result in some other paper.
Well, it's kind of, I'm not sure if it's there is a paper about it because it's kind of obvious if you just like look. So basically, if Jacobian, all the singular values of Jacobian are one, then if you compute f of x, then the norm of x and the norm of y are the same. And then you will do backpropagation, it will be the same. So the norm of the gradient will not change in the positive layers, which means that you, in principle, cannot have bench corresponding gradients problem, no matter how much layers you have.
Sorry. Am I right that Jacobian is simple? So, talk about eigenvalues instead.
Yes, we can talk about eigenvalues. But, so, the way they computed it, let's try to do it.
Jacobian in general is not square matrix. This is why we're talking about single values.
It will be like, let's look at rho of Jacobian. It will be derivative of W of normalized, its rows are unit length, have unit length. Then we use the chain rule. This thing is just the ith row, and this thing is an indicator, which tells us on which part of the radio we are now. So it would be
zero.
This is Heaviside function.
Y plus x. If we now compute Jacobian I transpose I, which is the diagonal entry of the diagonal entry of this matrix.
You don't need this assumption, just take the whole Jacobian.
I just want to compute the diagonal entry to see, to look at the. So this thing would be yi transpose yi times yi x squared, but it doesn't matter because it's 0, 1. Does it make sense? You just like multiply it by itself. And this is number and this is vector. So,
is it W or W wave?
Wave.
What is W wave?
It's a normalized W, like unit length. We don't want.
And where is all these constants?
No, they do not. I'm not sure actually, do they account for these constants after all? Because
and
they,
what about gamma and beta?
Yeah, I'm talking about them. So they used this analysis before introducing the constants, and they never like mentioned how to adapt it, but I think it can be done.
just didn't bother to do it.
And why single levels are equal to 1.2?
1.2 is for this.
Yes, this thing is 1, right?
Yes.
It's in clamp. This thing is 1. And finally, you have to put this constant. You have to put that constant.
Uh-huh.
And you also have to take the expectation of this thing.
Yes.
And it's 0.5. Like 1/2.
1/2.
Right?
1/2.
Because it's less.
Yeah,
1/2.
This part. So the question is, why don't we have that coefficient? We do. So the answer would be like 0.5 divided by
this square root.
I think like this.
And this is just 1.2, right?
Let me check. I don't know. I made a mistake, but it should be. So it would be.
So it's eliminated as 1/3.
Well, it looks.
I would say
close.
Yeah.
And it should be like approximately 1.2 squared, and it was singular value, and we were talking about eigenvalues before.
Actually, no. You were talking about single levels,
okay, sorry,
but
no,
okay, we believe that. Taking levels.
Okay, yeah, so that's.
Is it okay?
Single values here also.
Is it okay in the 1.2? Don't we have like exploding gradient?
Well, they say that they're reasonably close to 1, and they also initialize the gammas to be 1 divided by 1.2 and say that, and hope for the best. The cons are that they have really lots of assumptions, and it's in contrast to batch norm, you cannot just plug it inside the network in any place, and it will not work, because it assumes, first of all, that the inputs are also normalized. And second of all, it relies on the activation functions. And in the paper, they say like that it's easy to adapt these derivations to other activation functions, but they do not do it. So probably it's not that easy.
But it's really easy, because you just use a numerical integration for estimating this mean and variance for different activation functions. And moreover, if you take a sigmoid here, you obtain single value of Jacobian 1.03, much closer to 1. So it's better to use normalization propagation with sigmoid, because you don't have problems with exploding gradients, because you use normalization, and your single values are much closer to 1.
I mean, do they have an experiment when they show that this those singular values are affecting speed of convergence or some parameter?
You mean experiment not related to their technique, but just about singular values?
No, I mean they say that singular value helps, and then they show some experiments, right?
Yeah, but they do not control it. They just computed it for their layer and said that it's good. So we cannot compare it to.
But they argue that the lower it is, or closer it is to the 1, it's better.
It's standard thing, especially in the papers about counting networks. Like, there are a lot
of. Oh, it's standard then. Okay. No arguments needed. It's standard.
Good.
So it doesn't work.
You can read something like Hintree.
It does. You just treat like each.
I mean, like, it's still a bad practice. Like, if you argue something like that, it's.
But how do you normalize images?
It's not really that obvious.
The same way, we just independently apply the whole thing to each punch.
Appendixes?
Yes. Yeah.
When you hope for the best, what else is matters? I hope there's
sense.
Going to be sites.
I didn't know the details, but they claimed that somehow it even helps, that you have lots of correlation with correlated patches. But I do not know the details. Okay, so some experiments. Here they track, they just, at each layer, we have 9-layer neural network, and at each layer they choose one random
mirror and track its mean during the optimization and see if it's normalized or not. So with no normalization, it's kind of changed a lot and it's large, like hundreds. And with norm prob or batch normalization, it's around zero and it's more stable. You may argue that, like, why do we care about it?
With batch normalization, it's not.
Yes, batch normalization is slightly worse in terms of like logic, right? And it's also their claim that here we.
Why are all inputs positive in case of normalization?
And in case of batch normalization?
But not in the case of norm propagation.
It's activations, and when it's ReLU, it's only
okay.
One or zero or higher.
But these are inputs to neuron.
I think batch normalization
okay.
applies before ReLU, and they apply normalization after ReLU.
But again, you are plotting what? You are plotting inputs to neuron.
The whole thing, this OI.
So this is output.
Yes.
Oh, so actually the
this
output.
Reason that this is neural input. What?
So the output of batch normalization X actually couldn't be less than zero because
yes.
We have
yes.
a reward.
Well,
okay.
Inputs of this layer is the output of the previous layer, so it's that three manner.
Not exactly. Because inputs to next layer are out, a linear combination of outputs on previous layer, right?
No.
And linear combination can be negative.
I mean, so
yeah.
O would be like X for the next layer, right?
No.
No.
The sum of O's with weights.
Why? You have sum of O's with weights here.
But okay, what do you mean when you say the input? It's like this is a neuron. So for the next layer, it's simply one input, one
yes.
of a lot from the.
So actually,
input
the input of neuron will be linear combination of outputs from
yeah.
previous layer.
Yeah.
After
like this O is an X there for the next layer. So
it's,
we have
it's
a linear.
It's like one of the X's.
Yes, one
yeah.
of X's.
Yes.
So actually, we're taking a linear combination of these axes. And in
so
this linear combination, the coefficients can be negative.
Yeah.
Yes.
And they should be negative, some of them.
So what I'm saying is that they do not plot this thing.
Uh-huh.
They just plot this thing, or which is the same one of the axes here.
Okay.
Yeah.
None of this clear.
Okay. This. And also, they tried to use their thing with different batch sizes, and here epochs. So we have like, on, for example, 10 epochs, we have all networks seen the same amount of data, right? No matter which batch size it is. And here they say that like they converge more or less the same, which is kind of cool because you can use batch size 1, which you cannot with, for example, batch normalization.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think that's it.
That's quite impressive. Okay, any questions, dear speaker? All questions have been already asked during the presentation.
You didn't see any comparison of normalization and normal propagation even in some, I don't know, blogs or something like this.
Yeah, I haven't yet find it, but maybe
it's strange.
Didn't look.
So when the first version of this paper was published on our
site?
Normalization propagation.
I think it's from ICML last year, so it's probably like in January.
Yeah, of and weight normalization is leap, so
so what is the current state of batch normalization? Is it still useful or is it replaced by
no one using this kind of things for some
which
reason.
One?
So
norm prob and bait prob probably just the
not invented at Google?
Yeah.
What?
It's all 2015.
Batch norm was invented in Google, so they probably want to use it.
Yeah. Now the coolest thing is to invent Bayesian interpretation or Bayesian normalization techniques
in Google.
Well, actually, Maybe it's possible to at least at first see the batch normalization through Bayesian lens and then try to build upon that. I mean, take a look at that. It has estimate parameters that we estimate, the mean and scale. It kind of looks like global latent parameters that we estimate, that where the dependence between data comes from.
Well, you may consider such a model. The problem is that you're starting with batch normalization. You're already assuming that we'll have batch normalization layer, and now we'll try to invent some Bayesian interpretation for that. This is not good. It would be cool if we could derive this batch normalization layer from some Bayesian model. You see?
Well,
not vice versa.
Maybe, but we could first reverse engineer the model and that underlines batch normalization, and then.
You're welcome. I'll be happy to hear any considerations from you.
Once I have free time.
Once you will be at Google.
The nasty part about batch normalization, though, is that they backpropagate for these kind of computations, and it would be hard to find a Bayesian relation to that.
Maybe.
Okay, let us thank the speaker for bringing this talk. So, Michael.
He has left.
He has left?
Yep.
Oh, interesting. And who will declare who will be our next speaker then?
Today or on the next one?
I guess it's in the doc already. Probably Michael Hellman is the next one.
Either Brunaev or Hellman, but the question is who?
Brunaev.
I'm not sure. You sure? Okay. So then our next speaker will be guest and our good colleague from Skoltech, Professor Dini Brunaev. Who will tell about his recent results of his team on Gaussian processes.
Okay. Еще ниже.
На самом верху?
Да. Все изменилось.
Я, Брунаев.
Good. Офигеть, ну и похоже, научный.